We did not do a survey last year. It was a budget cut issue. At the time, we were making other cuts. And so as the economy has come back a little bit, we did do a citizen survey this year. And it's very similar to the format we've used in previous years. And we have today Chris Tatham with us, who's going to present the citizen survey findings to us. Chris?
Mayor, members of the council, it's a pleasure to be back. What I'm going to do today is kind of walk through the high-level findings. Obviously, there's a lot of data here, but I want to kind of make sure that you get the main messages that we think you should take away from the survey. For those of you who are new to the council and not familiar with our firm specializes in working with local governments to get input from residents to make better decisions. The reality is typically at meetings like this, you only hear from a small segment of the public, so sometimes it's hard to know whether or not you're really doing things right or not. So we use the information that we gather from the city of Oklahoma, and we also assess it in the context of many other communities. We do similar surveys for 12 of the 20 largest U.S. cities and 11 of the 20 largest U.S. counties. So as I go through the presentation, I'm going to talk about some of the findings in context of what we've seen happen elsewhere, and that's the basis for those comments. And here's just a few of the communities. I'm not going to read the list that's in the report, but we also provide some head-to-head comparisons for you. We do almost every major city, for example, along the I-35 corridor. So I go to San Antonio and Austin and Kansas City and Des Moines. And so, again, I'm going to be talking a lot about context today. As far as the agenda, I'm just briefly going to recap the purpose. I think most of you are familiar with that. I walk through the general methodology, which is exactly the same way we've done in previous years, and then talk about the major findings. I've highlighted a few of those, which I've called your headline story, which I think are the major takeaways from this year's survey. As far as the purpose of the survey, fundamentally it's to provide you some feedback about how well you're delivering services. Expectations change from one period to the next, and being aware of how expectations are changing is critical to meeting the needs of the community. In addition, it helps you assess what the priorities should be with regard to resident expectations. And those priorities aren't always aligned with what you know the priorities to be. So oftentimes you need to use the results of the survey to help guide the education, because residents might think X is a priority, but to get to X you might need to do Y. So there's a lot of things you can use with the survey to impact the awareness and priorities of the community through public information. With regard to the methodology of the survey, as I said, it was administered the same way this year as we've done in previous years. Our goal was to get 1,200 completed surveys citywide. We actually had 1,368 households participate. The results are not perfect, but if you did the survey the same way, 95 times out of 100, you'd expect to see the same results within about plus or minus 2.6%. So if you see changes from the last survey of 3% or more, they're probably statistically significant. We checked the composition of this year's survey against recent census estimates, and they tend to be fairly close. They're also close to the data we saw in previous years. So again, changes in the results are more a function of changing expectations and changing service levels than differences in the sample composition. We also do GIS mapping, and I don't have a lot of them in today's presentation, but if you actually want to see how people rate different services in different parts of the city, there's an entire section that has maps that show how people in different areas rate different services. I guess you'd have caution in interpreting those maps, though, because some areas only have a few respondents, so that data should be compared with other data sources to make sure it's interpreted correctly. With that said, this map just shows the general location of respondents. As you can see, basically people live, or the red dots are located where people are. Areas with higher density have more dots. Areas with lower density development have fewer dots. But all in all, this distribution mirrors the recent census maps that show the density of the city. So we felt real good about the demographic composition and the geographic composition of the survey. With that said, here's really the five kind of major takeaways, at least from my perspective. There's obviously a lot of other information here. But the first one is overall satisfaction with city services in the city of Oklahoma City is significantly higher than most other large cities in the United States. You're doing some things definitely right. Residents definitely have a very positive perception of the city and the direction the city is headed. I'm going to show you some numbers that really show how intense the favorable opinions about the direction of the city are, particularly in this year's survey. Although satisfaction remains high, compared to the last surveys, we have seen some decreased levels of satisfaction. I think what's happened is in 2009, when we did your last survey, the impact of the recent recession did not quite hit this city yet. And as a result, we've seen most cities across the country see lower satisfaction levels when compared to 2008 and 2009, and I think you're seeing a similar issue going on here now. And finally, the number one priority is clearly maintenance. You're going to see that at least from a resident perspective, and I'll show you why in just a little bit. So with those headlines, here's how we kind of got there. I'm going to kind of start off with perceptions of the city and then walk through some of the major findings in each area of service. The perception questions I consider to be kind of those strategic indicators about the health of a community. If you rate high in these areas, people are going to probably want to continue to stay here. You're going to be able to attract people here, and that's a long-term good. It's a good thing for the long-term health of the city. You can see most of the areas on here had very positive perceptions, feelings of safety, quality of downtown, overall how well the city is planning for growth. And you might look at those numbers and say, well, are those good or bad? How do we sort of stack up? So when you compare these numbers to the numbers for other large cities around the country that have populations of 250,000 or more, that's what's shown in this chart. The blue bars are for the results for Oklahoma City. The yellow bars are the results for the national average. And you'll see that you're above average in just about everywhere, a little bit below on quality of life, but it's not substantially different. But you are really setting the standard when it comes to overall quality of city services. You'll see that's at the bottom there. 64% or over nearly 2 out of 3 residents give positive ratings for how well you deliver services overall. Most large cities, fewer than half, or just 46%, give positive ratings. In addition, I think the perceptions of how well you're planning for growth, you're doing a lot of innovating and good things. Clearly, that's resonating strongly with the public because your rating is nearly double the national average for other large cities at 66% compared to 35%. So you're definitely doing some great things in that regard. In addition, we looked at the overall trends in satisfaction. You can see that they have decreased slightly from 2009. The overall rating at 64% still substantially higher than most other cities, but I think it's important that you be aware that you've seen some decreases. You hope that doesn't continue. The immediate cause is likely to be recessions and things like that, because I've seen that elsewhere. But if it continues, that would potentially be a concern in the future. With regard to the overall satisfaction based on where people live, what you see on this map is we've shaded the mean rating or the mean satisfaction rating by zip code throughout the city. And what's great about this is most of the city is almost the same color. In other words, you'll see that most people are satisfied regardless of where they live. You'll see some of the low density developments as you get to the east are a little bit lower levels of satisfaction. But again, those areas only have a low number of respondents, so the data should be interpreted in the context of other information as well. Key point here, though, is you're doing a great job generally throughout the city delivering high quality services. In addition, one of the things we want to find out is whether or not people think you're moving in the right direction. And we ask people how to rate the city as a place to live, work, and raise children. And this chart again shows the positive ratings, excellent and good, are in blue. Negative ratings are in red. And you can see clearly there's very little concerns about the city with regard to each of these items that were rated. The one I want to highlight, though, is the one that I put the little arrow to. This is the city's moving in the right direction. Because for every person that thinks the city isn't moving in the right direction, or that 8%, there's almost 10 that see the city is at 76%. Just a tremendous ratio. In addition, what impressed me even more about this chart is the percentage that are giving excellent ratings. 4 out of 10 people, 38%, are giving you the highest rating possible, which shows that you have a lot of people who really feel good about where the city is going. In fact, there's more people giving the excellent ratings for that item than any of the other areas that were rated on the survey. So you're really to be commended in these difficult times, because in most communities, people don't feel their local governments and state governments and the federal governments are moving in the right direction. So these ratios really impressed me when I was reviewing the results of the survey. Next thing I want to share with you are just some of the major findings. One of the things that we do is we ask people to kind of rate each of the major services that are delivered by the city, and then we actually get into some of the details about each of those services. So this first list here is kind of the overall ratings, how people rate fire, ambulance, police service, water utility services, and so forth. And you can see most of the services generally have high ratings. The one that clearly stands out, though, as a concern is your maintenance of your city streets, where you have 50% or half the people are not just giving average ratings or neutral ratings, they're actually giving negative ratings. And when you compare that to the positive ratings of just 24%, you actually have over a 2-to-1 ratio giving negative to positive. Public transit system also has some concerns, and you can see there's some concerns about traffic flow and court enforcement, but those aren't unusual for a city of this size. When we see how these ratings kind of stack up on the next page, you can see some of the things that I really want to highlight as strengths. Customer service here towers over other communities. You have an 18-point advantage at 61 to 43. So if other cities want to learn how to do customer service, they should come check out Oklahoma City. With regard to your communication, you're at 53% compared to 40%, so you're doing something right. Again, communication isn't typically rated really high, but you're doing it a lot better than most other large cities. Even traffic flow, which had higher levels of dissatisfaction and code enforcement, rate above the national average. But you can see in some of the other areas where you have some of the weaknesses, parks and recreation, I'm going to show you in a little bit, there's not a lot of dissatisfaction with parks and recreation, but these results are based on the combined positives. And here in Oklahoma City, you tend to have more neutral ratings, which isn't necessarily a problem, but people don't feel as good about their parks as in some of their other areas. And your water utility services, I think some of your issues related to fee changes have impacted that, because your overall ratings for the water service itself are very, very high. The one item, though, that has the most significant gap is maintenance of streets, and you can see you trail 13 percentage points behind the national average for other communities. And when we ask people what they thought the top priority is, not probably a real surprise given the concerns, maintenance of streets actually stood out by far as the top issue. In fact, more people picked it as a first choice than any of the other items' top three choices combined. So clearly, how you address that, putting that into your communication, letting people know what you're doing in that area, will get you a lot of mileage. Even if you don't have as many dollars to invest, it's important that the community believe that the city has a plan to address that as you move forward. And one of the things that we do is to kind of put this into an equation is often not as easy as this. Sometimes the top priority isn't the lowest rated area, but we have an index that we call the important satisfaction rating that essentially takes a look at how important a service is to residents and then the overall level of satisfaction. So as the importance goes to zero, this value goes to zero. If the satisfaction goes to 100, it also goes to a zero. On the other hand, if you have low levels of satisfaction and high importance, this value moves toward the value of 1. And you can see essentially this shows you what your marginal return on investments would be in different areas. And you can see maintenance of streets at 0.50 is clearly the highest area. Transit is a distant second with regard to the analysis that we conducted on the survey. But investments in streets will clearly have some significant benefits over the next couple years. In addition, if you're more of a, this is for, I guess, the left brain learners, those people who like visual things, we put the same information on a chart like this, and we essentially plot from left to right the importance, and from bottom to top is the satisfaction. The items that you get concerned about are the ones in the bottom right, and you can see the quality of public transit and maintenance of city streets are the ones that are furthest in that regard. This doesn't mean that you don't continue to fund ambulance service and fire service, but if you're going to make a lot of big deals about your investments in those areas, they're not going to yield the same returns on satisfaction because satisfaction levels are already very high. So it doesn't mean you don't do certain things, but your ability to get points toward people's perceptions of the city favorably with regard to satisfaction is greatly enhanced by investments in communication points targeted at the bottom right quadrant. With that, kind of the overall findings, we also broke the results of the survey down into some specific areas, one of which is public safety. We looked at things like police services in neighborhoods, enforcement of local traffic laws. Both generally had fairly high ratings. We also looked at issues about people's perceptions of safety in different parts of the city. And one of the things that you'll notice on this chart is there are a significant number of people who are dissatisfied, or I should say feel unsafe in city parks. In fact, 1 in 3 people indicated they did not feel safe in city parks. 30% indicated they didn't feel safe in city at night. Overall, your public safety ratings are among the very highest of all cities, but I think this is perhaps an emerging issue that you should be aware of so that your overall public safety rating doesn't go down in the future. And we see how you stack up in these areas to other communities. You see Oklahoma City was the second highest rated when it comes to public safety for your overall rating. But when it comes to some of the ratings specifically related to feelings of safety in parks and safety in neighborhoods at night, you can see you trail the average. There's a significant gap when it comes to feelings of safety in the park. So I think as you're moving forward, that's an issue to emphasize. Maybe it's with communication, it may be with investments, but clearly residents here are more concerned about it than residents in other communities. All in all, though, your public safety areas rate very well compared to most other large cities. When it comes to your utilities, we ask people to rate their satisfaction with various utilities, and what's great about this chart is almost everything's in high blue. If you look at this chart, speed of service, customer service, recycling, wastewater, water service, residential trash collection, bulky item pickup, all rate extremely high. And there's a real strong intensity of people giving very satisfied ratings. In other words, you have more than 25% of the customers in all areas giving you a 5 on a 5-point scale, suggesting you're doing something right. And this is, again, why I think some of the issues we saw with the lower ratings of overall for the overall quality was a little lower, more a function of price costs than actual service delivery. And when you see how you stack up to other communities, you see you're really setting the standard for residential trash and bulky item pickup. I'm sorry, I flagged the bulky item pickup because you're one of the very best in the nation at that, but you're also significantly above when it comes to residential trash service. So in a couple of the areas that really make a big difference in the way residents view the city from a customer service, the way you interact with them on a regular basis, you're really doing a great job in setting the standard. On your parks and recreation areas, this is what I was mentioning before. There's not a lot of dissatisfaction with parks in the city, but you see there's a lot of people who give kind of neutral ratings. And this isn't an uninformed rating. People who don't know, we exclude those. People don't actually say I'm neutral about parks. They rate things on a 1 to 5 scale. So this is a 3, which typically indicates somebody hasn't had a real good experience, nor have they had a really bad experience, but they're informed. And one of the things that I see looking at your survey results is there's not a lot of people who feel really intensely positive about the parks. You see, all of the items rated had fewer than 20% of the people giving very satisfied. So I think there's significant opportunities here, probably relative low amounts of dollars, to cause people to feel better about the park system. And the reason I say that is people who give ratings of 3 oftentimes are the most easily affected by communication, education, and small investments. Doing little things causes somebody who's a 3 to suddenly be a 4. And you don't have a lot of dissatisfaction, so there's not a lot of negative hurdles to overcome. And when you see how you stack up to other communities, you see a couple of the areas about average. The overall quality of park facilities and athletic fields, though, do rate behind other large cities, with the athletic fields being about 15 points behind the national average. When it comes to opportunities for investment, walking and biking trails, you can see is the top of the list. Pools and continued maintenance of parks kind of round out the top 3. And you can see walking and biking trails got to the top of the list because it in some ways has some of the most dissatisfaction overall among the areas that were rated on the survey. The next area we looked at was code enforcement. And you can see code enforcement kind of has a core group that's dissatisfied. But generally, you see the percentage of people giving positive ratings compared to negatives is generally very favorable. There are a lot of folks, again, in the middle that are giving neutral ratings, which through communication and education about what you're doing, do suggest you have opportunities to cause those people to feel better about code enforcement services. And when you see how you stack, or I guess the top priorities within code enforcement, we didn't have any comparisons here. You can see that the overall enforcement of mowing and grass on private property is the top issue. Cleanup of litter and debris is the second issue, followed by the exterior upkeep of residential property. Those are the sets. You have several items that really rank relatively high in this category. One of the last areas I want to kind of emphasize is maintenance. I like to start good and kind of go into some of the areas that really have the most opportunity. And you can see here when you look at the maintenance issues, there's really not a lot of major concerns in general except with the very last item. You see condition of major streets is clearly the driving factor for concerns. You can see conditions of streets and neighborhoods have 31% of residents giving dissatisfied ratings. But when we actually compare the city of Oklahoma City to other cities, you actually have better than average ratings for your neighborhood streets, but significantly lower ratings for the maintenance of major streets. So that's, unfortunately, major streets are the most costly to take care of, but that's clearly where some of the concerns exist. There are also some concerns about the cleanliness of city streets and public areas as well. And when you see how you stack up to your benchmarking pool, unlike public safety, where you're right at the very top of the list, you can see you're near the bottom when it comes to overall perceptions of maintenance at 24% compared to an average of 37%. And it's not a surprise that condition of major streets is by far the top priority in the important satisfaction analysis we did. A couple other highlights are with your communication. Overall, what really strikes me with your communication is almost a complete absence of concerns about it. Very, very low levels of dissatisfaction. Many large cities have 20, 30, 40% of their residents not happy with how well the city communicates. I think that's one of the reasons your overall ratings are much higher than the national average. You get good ratings for your website, for programming on City Channel 20, and you can see even your perceptions of the city's website as a way to transact business with the city generally get pretty positive ratings. Your customer service, I say perhaps the best for last. You might remember your customer service ratings are setting the standard for the nation, and I think one of the reasons for is the intense positive reaction that residents have had to their experiences with city employees. You can see the overall high percentage of people who are giving very satisfied ratings, and you do that, remember, these are the same people who, there's hardly any of them giving positive ratings in some of the other areas, not a lot of negativity. They're much more opinionated, but in this case, it's not a surprise that you do have a core group of people who are dissatisfied with certain elements. But this suggests to me that your employees are doing something right in the way they interact with customers. Otherwise, you wouldn't have an overall customer satisfaction rating that's substantially higher than the average for other large cities. So just to summarize, these are essentially the same key points I showed you earlier. I think the city of Oklahoma City should be very proud of the fact that you're really setting the standard for overall delivery of city services. Your rating's significantly higher than the national average. We've seen some areas decrease since the last survey. I think a lot of that probably is due to recession and other factors that we've seen ratings cause other community ratings to go down the last couple years. But to move forward in a positive way, having plans to address some of the concerns, particularly maintenance of streets, I think will be critical to make sure you continue to gain the confidence in these high late ratings from the public in the future. So, Mayor, with that, I don't know if anyone has any questions, but...
How many surveys do you send out? How many do you mail out?
For this sample, I think we had 2,500 households were selected, so a little over half, I think, participated. It may have been 3,000, I don't, but it was between 2,500 and 3,000.
And then you study the census and you try and emulate that or match?
What we do is we take a look at the number of households that are currently in the city, and we then select a random sample of those. In this case, it was probably 2,500 to 3,000. Those households are then...
How do you find those 3,000?
We select them at random. Imagine that there's every household, let's say there's 200,000, 50,000 households in the city. I'm just pulling that number out. Every number household, we give a unique record between 1 and 250,000. We then generate a random list of numbers, 3,000
okay.
unique numbers between 1 and 250,000. Those households are then the ones that are selected.
Do you know the ethnicity of those households?
We don't until after we do the survey. But what we do is if we get a good distribution when we're all done, the ethnicity of our sample should mirror the ethnicity of the city, and that's one of the things that we take a look at. In this case, it generally does.
So after the fact, you look at those 1,368 that came back, and you compare that to the census.
Exactly.
What was the cost of this study for the city?
Probably around $34,000, $35,000, $32,000.
What would it be possible to do this in a? And Jim, I guess I would ask you, could you do this in an automated fashion over the phone?
If you
your sample
don't
time?
Really care that people participate, you can do it on the internet for a lot less. The real key thing here is this is a 15-minute survey. You're calling people who really aren't typically engaged with local government, and you're trying to make sure that this tool gives you a perception of those people you don't always hear from. If you do automated surveys, which are now available, where you call people, push this to participate in the survey, what will happen is they'll typically just hang up. The people who you'll end up hearing from are likely to be the same people who always turn out to these events. I've worked with a lot of communities, and I do other types of surveys that are much lower cost. But what happens is the people who will participate will tend to mirror the people you hear from anywhere anyway. So as a result, a survey of this has very little value.
I mean, you're only getting 50% of the people to participate that you send out mailings to, so I'm not sure that that wouldn't apply to that also. When you When you call them by follow-up on phone, how much time are you spending with them? What are you asking?
We do several things. First, we do an automated message from the mayor to let people know that it's important. We then send them a survey in the mail. We then call them by phone if they're not able to do it at that time or if they haven't already participated. We then schedule a time to call them back. We then call them back at that time. And the 50% participation rate, just to let you know, is extremely good. In fact, I suspect it's a little higher than your local voter election turnout. Yeah, most surveys, typically you're lucky to have 5 to 10% of most people in typical surveys to respond to a survey like this. So I think your community is extremely engaged. And compared to other community surveys I do, the level of response here is much, much higher.
I think a robocall from the mayor would cost $150. Is $35,000 to the taxpayer? I mean, do you think that's reasonable? Are you familiar with other, do we get bids on?
We go through a selection process, an open selection process, where we have people submit proposals to us, and based upon the qualifications of those people, we negotiate a fee. And I think this is a pretty good value for $35,000.
Okay.
To have information of this magnitude and the amount of sampling that was done.
Okay.
And the ability to compare it on a national basis under similar results, I think, is very, very valuable. I mean, to know how we rank up against those other cities. So I believe it's value.
Okay.
But that's a policy issue of council to decide. Mm-hmm.
That's what I want to know. Thanks.
Okay. Sure. Comments or questions?
I had a question, Gary. When you do all the comparisons to other major cities, you use the above 250,000. Is that a standard break or a natural break? I mean, is there only one break, or can you do above 500,000?
We do 500,000 for some cities. There's not a substantially difference in the results. We've typically done 250,000 above for you, so we've stayed with that. Some cities like San Francisco and Dallas and Boston, some of the other communities we work with, they use a 200 or 500,000 level, so we can do both. But those are our breaks internally, so we can pull out the data. We either have it broken down by 500,000, 250,000, 100,000, 50,000, and then 20,000.
Would you suspect if you moved up to 500,000 that we would do better or worse?
Yeah, you would actually fare a little better. In fact, when you get to 500,000, the overall results drop about another 5 to 6%. So if we did that, it would make you look even better than you do in this report.
That's kind of a question I had, because if you do 250,000 cities, and they're typically geographically smaller than we are, they would do better, I think, in some areas, whether it be parks or streets or anything else, depending on what they had to maintain versus what we did. So I was just curious, if you moved us up closer to something that's more comparable to us, what do you think it'd be?
The only area that really lags significantly, and I guess I pulled this up, is in maintenance. And I didn't spend a lot of time on the maintenance chart, but you might have seen yourselves there at 24%. The average was 37%. In other large cities, most of the cities in that chart are above 500,000.
Okay.
So,
right.
So the overall rating at 250,000, when people look at city services across the board, you're at 64% compared to the average of 46. So you're doing great in most areas. The maintenance issue is the one area where there's really the significant gap. And when you look at the result, I think it was right here, you can see here's several other cities that are on the list, and we can pull out things like San Antonio, large geographic city, they have 45%. Dallas, not quite as big, but at 35%. You can see Indianapolis at 32%. Austin, 46%. I don't have San Francisco or Boston, but they're also higher than you are. So at the end of the day, you're 24%, even when you just pick it out to a handful of other large cities of over 500,000, the comparisons don't help you a lot. It's still your rating near the lowest area. And so that's why this is, of all the issues in your survey, the area we've identified as the biggest concern.
Chris. The benchmarking communities, did your company perform the same with all these other cities?
Exactly. So it's an identical survey. So that way the comparisons aren't kind of derived from different scales. We've administered the same survey in these other places that we administered here.
All right. Thank you. Do you have your data broken down by ward or area of the city?
It can be. And so what we've done is we've geocoded the home address of each of the respondents to the survey. so the data can be broken down really at any level of geography that you'd like. It can be broken down by ward level. It can be broken down into planning areas. So you might remember this map at the very beginning. At the end of the day, if you wanted to actually see the data for different areas of the city, you're able to do that.
All right. We appreciate your work. Thank you very much.
It's great to be here. Thank you.